So welcome to today's class. In today's class, we are going to look at some other features, some other tasks that are included in the data flow task. So the tasks that we're going to look at today are the lookup and the join task. Now, what exactly we are going to do? So we have a table. We're going to go to the SQL server. And we have a table in our AdventureWorks database that is known as the, there's a table called the Employee Department History. So if you click on that and check out the columns, you'll see there are columns called the Business Entity ID, Department ID, and so on. So this table, Human Resources or Employee Department History, it is connected to the employee table and the department table. So it is linked through these two foreign keys, which are the business entity ID and the department ID, to the employee and the department table. Now, if we want to fetch the data of all the employees which are present in this table and which can be referenced to the business entity ID, then we need to join this table with the HR employee table, which is this table, on the business entity ID and fetch the data which is present in this table. So if we go to the human resources or employee table, we will see that there's a business entity ID and there's a national ID number and so on, other details for the employees present in this table related to the business entity ID. Now, if we take a look at this table, so we replicated this table last time in our own database, which was the SSDT database. So if we just take a look at the records in this table and we do a select star from HR or employees, then you will see that this is the data in this table, business entity ID and so on, right? So there are 12 rows if you order them. Then you'll be able to see. So there are rows like this, okay? Okay, so these are the records in your table. There are 12 rows and there's a column called business entity ID. And we're going to fetch the national ID number from this table for the employees which are present in the human resources or employee department history table and which are referenced by the business entity ID. So to perform this join, what we need to do in our control flow, in our SSIS task, is basically go to the control flow. So we have created a new package. By default, its name is package.ddsx. Then we can see the control flow. Now we need to read the data from this table and join it with the data from another table. So this is going to be a data flow task. So we need to add a data flow task to a package. So just drag and drop from the left hand side. And now we have a data flow task and we can give it a meaningful name. So you can say fetch employee data, and then we need to configure this data flow task. So double click on it and we will move to the data flow window over here. So now we need to read the data which was present in the employee department history table. So we need again an OLEDB source for that. So we have to find where is that source. Just drag and drop again. And then we need to configure that source. Now the other table which we are joining with is also a database table. It's also a SQL Server table. So we need another OLEDB source task to read from that table. So we'll just put it over here. And now we need to perform a join between those two tables. So we have to find a task which can do that for us. And that task is the merge join task. So just click on merge join, drag and drop, and put it over here. This is your merge join task. Now let's configure each of the stages. So double click on the OLEDB source first stage, and again we can give it a meaningful name. So let's do that first. This is our, this is your table employee department history. So let's just say table employee department, and then this one is a table employee. The table employee. Okay, now let's configure this. So table employee department, we need to configure an OLEDB connection manager. We have not specified any manager, so we have to click on new, and then it lists the ones that we have already created for the previous packages. So we can select one, the adventure was, because we are reading from there. Say okay. The table access mode is going to be table or view. So let it be table or view for now, and we'll see how it matters. And then the table that we are going to select is the employee department history. So just select it from here. Say okay. Now this table employee. Now this one we are going to select not from the Adventure Works database. So go to the new from our SSDT database. So say okay, table of view, and then the HR employees table. Columns and everything are mapped. Okay. And now we are going to join the output links from these two tasks to a join stage. So just drag and drop. And it says which output you want to select. OLEDB source output, that is the only output coming from that OLEDB source task. But on which input do you want that? So do you want it to be on the left input or the right input? Now it is asking this because it performs joins, which can be the left join, the right join, the inner join, or the full join. So the left join, if we are performing a left join wherein all the data from the left link will be fetched and only the matching data from the right link will be fetched, we have to specify that this is going to be a left input link. So we'll make it a left input link, say okay. Now another table, the right input link is table employee. So again, drag the output link from this table task to the join stage, and automatically it will take it as the right link because the other link we have already defined as the left link. So now we have our two tables, the left link and the right link. We have connected them to the join stage. Now this output, I can write to any file, I can write to any database destination. So because I'm just demonstrating right now and we do not really want to write, we just want to see how the data is going to flow. So I'm going to use a task which is called the Union All task. Now this task has a purpose. It combines input from multiple sources, so acts like a Union All in a SQL Server database command. But it also works as a debugging task. So we can just put it over here, and this will actually complete a flow. We do not need to put a destination separately in that case. So just join the output link from the join stage to the Union All stage, and then the package would be complete and we'll be able to execute the package for our debugging purposes. So we can just put that stage wherever we just want to debug. We do not really want to write the data to any destination. Now the merge join has a cross on it, so we still need to configure the properties of the merge join. So double click on it. Now, as soon as you double click on this task, you will see that it says that the isSorted property must be set to true on both sources of this transformation. So this is the error that you get. It will not allow you to configure this stage any further until and unless this property is set to true on both the sources of the transformation. Now what does this exactly mean? The isSorted property is a property that we will see on the output link, and it basically means that the input to the merge join stage or the merge join task needs to be sorted on both the links, the left link as well as the right link. So the stage needs the input sources to be sorted, the input data to be sorted to be able to perform well. Now, if you go to the table employee department and click on it, you will have columns, error output. So there's no if sorted property to be set over here. So what you need to do is select the stage, right click, and go to advanced editor. So select the stage, the OLEDB source stage, right click, and go to show advanced editor. And there you will get all these tabs. You have to go to the input and output properties. Now you have to select your OLEDB source output, and you will see that there's a property called is sorted over here, which is set to false. Now to be able to make this as an input link to a MergeJoin task, you have to set this to true. So set this to true over here. Now once you've set this to true, just go back over here and expand this drop down. Go to your output columns. Select the column on which you would want to be sorting, which would be your key column on which you're going to perform your join. So go to business entity ID, and you will see a column called the sort key position here, which has to be specified as 1, because this is the column we are sorting by, and the order of sorting is going to be 1, which is ascending, and this is the first column. So you are basically writing select all these columns from your source table, order by business entity ID. So if there were going to be multiple columns, then you would have, and let's say we would have ordered like order by business entity ID, department ID, then the sort key position for business entity ID would have been 1, and for department ID it would have been 2. But for now we are only performing the join on the business entity ID, so we do not need to specify the position for any other column. And say okay over here. So similarly we need to do for the other table. So right click, show advanced editor, go to the input and output properties, connect the OLEDB source output, change the is sorted option to true, then expand the source output links, go to the output column, and the column you're performing the join on, put the sort key position as 1. Now, if we go and double click on the MergeJoin task, it does not give us that error that the is sorted property must be set to true. It allows us to configure the stage. Now, we have already specified this as a sort key by specifying the sort key position. So, it has wisely been able to understand that the key, that the join has to be on this particular column. So it has already included that in the join. Now, this is my left link. You can see this is my right link. The kind of join that I am performing, I can see it over here, join type, inner join. And if you click on this, a drop down will be there. And you can select inner join, left outer join, or full outer join. So you have different options that you can perform. You can perform a left outer join or a full outer join. So there is no option for the right outer join, which would effectively be your left outer join if you change the positions of your input links. If you define your right input link as your left input link, left as your right, then that becomes a right join. Okay. What is an inner join? Inner join is basically where only the matching records from both the input links will be written to the output. That is an inner join. What is a left outer join? A left outer join, all the records from your left input link will be written to the output. Any columns, any records that match from the right input link will be written with values to the output. All the remaining records from the left input link which did not find a match in the right input link will have nulls for the columns which have been fetched from the right input link. So left outer join is basically all the records from the left input link and only the matching records from the right input link. For all the other remaining records for which there are no matches in the right input link, null values will be written to the output. What is a full outer join? A full outer join is basically all the records from the left input link as well as all the records from the right input link will be written to the output. The matching records in the right input link for the left input link will have values and vice versa. And any records which are not matching, all the left records, any non-matching records in the right input line will have values as null. All the right records which do not find a match in the left input link will have values as nulls. So this is a full outer join. Now, if you perform an inner join, if you're going to perform an inner join, you're only going to have all the matching values from both the links. Now, let's say we want to change it to a left outer join. Okay. So now you have an option over here which says swap input, which basically means you can now define the link that you have defined as your left input link as a right input link and the right one as a left input link. So you can swap the left and right between the input links. Now this is a left outer join, and this is going to be a left link, which is a table employee department, and the right link is going to be table employee. Now we said it's a left outer join, and how it works is all the records from the left input link will be outputted. So all the records are going to come from here, all the columns are going to go to the output. From the right input link, I have an option to choose which columns I want to be added to the output. Now what I wanted to do was basically fetch employee information for the business entity ID in my table employee department. So the employee information I'm interested in is basically the ID number of the employee, which is your national ID number. So what I'm going to do is check this box over here. And it is going to say table employee and the national ID number input column. The output alias is going to be your national ID number. So that is what I am going to check. If you select business entity ID, then it shows you from which table it is taking those two columns. So even if you do not, it will take it. So just say okay. So now I have defined my join. Let's go back, double click on it. Okay, so there are no other options. That is, those are the only options we have over here. So I've performed the join. Now I have added the union all stage, which is more likely a debugging destination stage. So where will my output will be written? How will I be able to see the output? For that, I need to select that link. Right click over here and enable data viewer. So now I'll be able to see how my data flows in this task. So now to execute this task, save the package, and start. So you'll get all these messages over here. Okay. So it basically says that union all output contains no columns. So we need to configure this as well. So the build failed during validation, which is a good thing. So just click on that and output column name. There's no union all input one, ignore. Okay, so there are no output columns over here. Let's add this over here. Say okay. Go to union all. Error at fetch employee data union all dot output union all output one contains no output columns and asynchronous output must contain output columns. Okay. Okay, so just select. It should have taken it automatically, but since it has not, we are just going to select the columns manually. So just go over here and go to the drop down and select your columns. Say okay. And save. Good. Okay, so this is what I've got in the output, which is a national ID number. Okay, but I also wanted to view that. Okay, so this has, the package has run fine. So let's go back over there and go back, edit, go to data here. We also want to view the business entity ID, so just add it over here. All right. Okay, so I've just added both the columns. It was showing us only one column. So we'll run it again. And now you can see what are the results that we have got. So the business entity ID and the values associated with that. So we had a business entity ID of 1. It did not find a match in the table, the employee table. So it says null. For the other columns where it found a match, it has values displayed for the national ID number column. And then for the remaining columns for which it never found a match, all those will have a value called null. Okay, so this is our left outer join, in which all the columns from the left link come, and only the matching records from the right input will have the values in them. For all the other records in the right input, and the left input which did not find a match in the right input link, you would have null values. So this is how this would work. Now let's take a look at the data, at the output that we've got. Now we had a left outer join, we defined a table and we did a lookup in the HR employees, or we did a join with the HR employees table. This is our HR employees table. If I do a select star, then I get 12 rows here. And in my data output over here, I can see that for the business entity ID 1, the national ID number is taken as null. But if I go back to my table and I see the data over here, I can see that there are records with the value 1 over here, which have some values for the national ID number, but it was not able to join on the 1. And it has given the output as null, which is incorrect. So the join has not given the desired output. The output is wrong. Now, why has this happened? This happened because we defined the isSorted property to be true, which basically means we have stated that the data coming from a source input link has been sorted. But that property, setting it to true, does not sort the data. It is just a hint to the next stage, to the join stage, that yes, the data has been sorted. It's kind of a check. It does not go and sort the data. To sort the data, you have to explicitly define the sort on the key column. To define the sort, the two options, either you can go and use your sort task stage and add it to both the stages, or you can double click and sort at the table level itself. So if you want to do that, then you have to configure your properties again. So double click on your OLEDB source, and then instead of doing a data access mode of table or view, go and do a SQL command wherein you can do your sort itself. So now I'm going to use the SQL command. It says select your business entity ID and national ID number and sort and order by business entity ID. Now, as we mentioned last time, sorting at a database level is always faster than sorting at your workflow level, because it's an asynchronous transformation. Sorting would take a lot of memory if we do it as part of a package, whereas if we do it in a database, it's always going to be faster. So we are going to do that. Instead of using the sort task, we're going to use the SQL command and include the order by clause in a SQL command itself. All right, let's check the columns. Okay. So just say okay over here. Similarly, you need to do over here as well. You need to instead of doing a table overview, you need to sort your input using your SQL command statement. So SQL command, and let's check this. So this is the table name. Let's verify the table name is going to be human resources. Employee.history. Now, there is no national ID number over here. No. Just take one. Oh, sorry. This is going to be your table name over here and order by business entity ID. Okay. The columns in the output are going to be business entity ID and all that is okay. Just say okay. Go back to your merge join, business entity ID, national ID number. You have these columns flowing to your output. Let's check the union all. Union all is okay. Let's check the data viewer. It includes both the columns. Go to data viewer, right click, it includes all the columns. It all looks okay. Let's do a save and run again. And now you can see that you have the correct output because the input now indeed has been sorted and we have not just gone and marked that property as true. So this needs to be a check whenever you are reviewing a data package, that any other developer has probably developed and you're reviewing that package. Then just checking that property does nothing. It just, anyways, you have to check that property if you want to make or configure your merge join stage. So just that, but always remember that just checking that property or setting it to true will not actually go and sort your data. So you have to make sure, you have to double click, open your sources and make sure that there is either a sort task or an explicit database order by included in your SQL command. So now we have got the correct results. Earlier we did not get the correct results. So this is very important for the merge join stage. All the input links have to be sorted on your key on which you are going to perform the join. Now, another thing that I want to highlight over here is that there are two matching records for the business entity ID one. And this is because there are actually two records in my database table, and this also left out a join. So this is how a join would work. If there are two records, related records in your right link, then you will get two outputs because two matches will be found in your right link, and therefore there would be two output records returned to your target or your destination. So this is how a join stage will work or a join task will work. Okay, it's very easy. The task itself is very easy to configure. There is nothing to be configured as such. You just need to define your left link and the right key and the key on which you need to perform the join, which would be decided by the key which you mentioned here as a sorted and your sort key order. And then you have to make sure that you order by or sort your input data on both the links, which is going to the join stage. So this is how you can perform a join in your SSIS. Now again, a join could also have been performed directly. You could have been taking just one OLED source and you could have performed your join at the database level itself. It is always faster doing any operation at database level is always faster, but when the data is huge, then performing a join in your SSIS might be faster. So you have to explore all these options. If there's an option to perform the join at your database level itself, then always go for that. But if the data is huge and the logic is complicated, then you have to take a use of the join stage. Or maybe you're reading the data from a file, so you cannot perform a join at your source level itself. So in those scenarios, you have to go for the merge join task and explicitly design a merge join task in your data flow task. So this is how a merge join would work. Now there's a similar stage called the lookup stage. So that is, that performs a similar function. A lookup stage also performs a join, and in that case, instead of calling it a write link, we'll be calling it a reference link. So now this table employee becomes a reference link. So similar output can be achieved by performing a lookup as well. Lookups are mostly performed when you have a reference data set. So your reference data set is actually small and can be held effectively in the memory. So that is your scenario for a lookup to be performed. A join is basically you have your two links, both of them have similar amount of data coming in, then you perform a join. Lookups are basically used with reference data sets or reference data, or where your reference data would not be too large, so it would not be too huge. It would be large enough so that it can be held in memory for efficient lookup operation. Otherwise, your join would be faster because the input data is sorted. Now, instead of using a join over here, we are going to use a lookup stage over here. So before we move on to the lookup stage, just take 2-3 minutes to go through the stage. And if you have any questions, just type them